solid ground. The nations rise and fall, kingdoms once strong now shaken. We trust forever in your name, the name of Jesus. Whoa, we trust the name of Jesus, the only King forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever, forevermore. You are victorious, you are the only King forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever, forevermore. You are victorious. Unmatched in all your wisdom, in love and justice you will reign. And every knee will bow. We bring our expectations. Our hope is anchored in your name, in the name of Jesus. Whoa, we trust the name of Jesus. You are the only King forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever, forevermore. You are victorious. You are the only King forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever, forevermore. You are victorious. Our banner high, we lift the name of Jesus. From age to age you reign, your kingdom has no end. We lift our banner high, we lift the name of Jesus. From age to age you reign, your kingdom has no end. And you are the only King forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever, forevermore. You are victorious. You are the only King forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever, forevermore. You are victorious. You are victorious.
Amen.
Man.
Amen. You guys all know that famous line in Forrest Gump, life's like a box of chocolates, you never know what you're going to get. And it's accurate to say the least, at least in my opinion it is. It's funny how things can be going so good and then bam, life will happen. And when things get tough and discouragement sets in, it's super easy to make boneheaded mistakes, and I'm the poster child for that. But I just want to let you know, our stumbles and our trips and falls, they don't define us. Praise the Lord for that. I feel so lucky that my stumbles and trips and falls don't, they're not who I am in Christ, right? You guys join me in this next song as we sing Our Father's House. Sometimes on this journey, get lost in my mistakes. What looks to me like weakness is a canvas for your strength. My story isn't over, my story's just begun. And failure won't define me, 'cause that's what my Father does. But failure won't define me, 'cause that's what my Father does. Ooh, lay your burdens down. Ooh, here in the Father's house,
check your shame at the door, 'cause it ain't welcome anymore. Ooh, you're in the Father's house. Arrival's not the end game. The journey's where you are. You never wanted perfect, you just wanted my heart. And the story isn't over if the story isn't good. The failure's never final when the Father's in the room.
Yeah.
The failure's never final when the Father's in the room. Lay your burdens down. Ooh, here in the Father's house. Check your shame at the door, 'cause it ain't welcome anymore. Ooh, you're in the Father's house. Prodigals come home, the helpless find hope. Love is on the move when the Father's in the room. Prison doors fling wide, the dead come to life. Love is on the move when the Father's in the room. Miracles take place, the cynical find faith. Love is breaking through when the Father's in the room. The Jericho walls are quaking, strongholds now are shaking. Love is breaking through when the Father's in the room. Oh, I said love is breaking through when the Father's in the room. Ooh, lay your burdens down. Check your shame at the door, 'cause it ain't welcome anymore. Ooh, you're in the Father's house.
Praise the Lord. Real quick, we're going to pray over the offering here, and for those of you joining us online, thank you so much for joining us this morning. Guys, there's an offering box in the back on the wall, or the back wall there, and or you can give online or in our app. I'd love to pray over it real quick if you join me. Lord, I'd ask that you would bless this offering this morning. Father, bless your people as they give to you today. And I pray that the offering and the tithes this morning would make a lasting impact for your kingdom. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen.
Lord, I come, I confess, bowing here, I find my rest, and without you, I fall apart. You're the one that guides my heart. And Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Sin runs deep, your grace is more. Where grace is found is where you are. and where you are, Lord, I am free. Holiness is Christ in me.
Lord, I need you.
Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh, oh God, how I need you. So teach my song to rise to you. When temptation comes my way, and when I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. 'Cause Jesus, you're my hope and stay. When I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. 'Cause Jesus, you're my hope and stay. You're my stay. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh, God, how I need you. You're my one defense, my righteousness. Oh, God, how I need you.
Heavenly Father, we just confess this morning, God, how much we need you this morning, Lord. Father, we realize that we are nothing except dust, Lord. Walking this earth, Lord, as travelers, as strangers here. And Lord, as much as we even try to be good, Lord, we realize that we are not perfect. And so we come to you, Lord, broken, needy, Father, messed up at times, and yet you still welcome us with open arms, Lord. And Jesus, we thank you so much for that, your death upon the cross that has paid for all of our sin, Lord. And Lord, I thank you that through faith, by trusting in you, all of our sin, yesterday, today, tomorrow, has been washed white as snow. And so, Lord, we don't take that for granted, but we remember this morning the sacrifice that you made for us upon the cross. And Jesus, we rest in you today, Lord. We say thank you, Lord, for loving us. Thank you, Jesus, for coming for us. Thank you for dying for us, Lord, for receiving the punishment that was due us upon yourself and giving us your righteousness. We say thank you, Jesus. I'd like to invite you, church, to participate in communion along with me this morning. We've got the prepackaged containers here. If anyone didn't receive one on your way in one of the baggies, if you want to slip your hand up, we can get one to you. Coming over there. Thanks for raising your hands. So just as Jesus and his disciples were together at that Last Supper, and even at that point, things were so interesting. Judas was about to betray Jesus. Jesus calls him out on it, and yet they still participate in communion together. Jesus offers the bread and offers the wine. To remember, he said, who he is and what he was going to do for them. So this morning as we partake, we remember what Jesus has done for us. On the night he was betrayed, he took bread, and after giving thanks, he said, do this in remembrance of me. So let's go ahead and partake of our wafer this morning. Thank you, Lord Jesus. We thank you for your body that was whipped, that was beaten, that was broken, Lord, so that we can be free, God, so that we can experience deep healing
and deep forgiveness. Thank you, Jesus, for that. It says in the same way, after they ate, he took the cup. He said, "This is now the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you remember me." So let's partake of the cup this morning. Lord Jesus, we thank you for your blood, the blood of the new covenant, a better way, Lord, that made being right with you not about us, but about you. And Lord, we thank you, Jesus, that your blood covers us and washes us white as snow this morning, Lord. Father, bring to remembrance those things, God, that we still need to lay down at your cross this morning. Jesus, that we still need to confess and make right with you, Lord, knowing, God, that as we turn to you, our sins are forgiven. I thank you, Lord, so much for your people, God, and I pray that you bless them this morning. In the name of Jesus, all that God's people said, amen.
Spoke a word, you were singing over me. You have been so, so good to me. Before I took a breath, you breathed your life in me. You have been so, so kind to me. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. Oh, it chases me down, fights till I'm found, leaves a 99. Still you give yourself away. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. Yeah, I was your foe, still your love fought for me. You have been so, so good to me. When I felt no worth, you paid it all for me. You have been so, so kind to me. Though the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God, oh, it chases me down, fights till I'm found, leaves the 99. I couldn't earn it. Still you give yourself away. Though the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. Yeah. Shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. Shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. Oh, it chases me down, fights till I'm found, leaves the 99. I couldn't earn it, I don't deserve it, still you self away. Oh, the overwhelming, never ending, reckless love of God.
Father, you are amazing.
Lord, we thank you for chasing us down daily. And Father, we submit ourselves to you here and now, Lord. Lord, I ask you to bless the sermon that Ryan has prepared for us this morning. And Lord, bless our small groups that we will be starting, Lord. I pray that they'll be the vehicle for you to use for change in Frazee, Lord. I pray for a revival, a wildfire to start here in Frazee, Lord, and begin with your servants here today. In Jesus' name we pray this. Amen.
Amen.
You may be seated.
Thanks, Michelle. Yes, children are free to go. Thank you so much. I am super excited about the different life groups that are starting up this week, and really do want to encourage you, if you're not signed up yet, to go ahead and get signed up, join a group. Of course, two of the groups are starting pretty much right after church today. Feel free to hop in, try it out, see if it's something for you, and we'll go from there as far as the other groups go. This morning, we're going to continue on. This is going to be the last of our series that I've titled Carriers. And today, we're going to be preaching about being carriers of repentance. Carriers of repentance. Of course, the whole idea behind this series is that people are very afraid to be around another person that might be a carrier of coronavirus. And of course, there's a lot of drummed up fear, and there's a lot of actual fear about that. And ultimately, as followers of Jesus, I feel like that we should be carrying something very different than fear. That God has called us during this time to be carriers of faith, carriers of peace, carriers of hope, carriers of truth, carriers of love. And today I felt like the Lord led me to take a look at what it means to be a carrier of repentance. If you get nothing else out of the sermon today, remember this. Repentance always comes with a reward. Say it with me. Repentance always comes with a reward. There's always an and attached to repentance, or a future promise, or something good will come when we repent. An example, Acts chapter 2, verse 38, it says, "And Peter said to them, 'Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the forgiveness of your sins.'" So there's the repentance, and here's the "and." "And you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit." Now, that's an awesome blessing. If you've ever been filled by God's presence through the Holy Spirit, it's an amazing experience. And He aims to fill us each and every day that we open our lives to Him. So repent, and there's always a reward that follows repentance. Repentance always has a reward. In Acts 3:19, it says, "Repent then and turn to God so that your sins may be wiped out, that times of refreshing may come from the Lord, and that He may send the Messiah who has been appointed for you, even Jesus." So again, repent and you're going to receive. There is always a reward that follows repentance. So, whenever God is in the mix. I love the songs that Mike picked for this morning. You know, there's no shame in the Father's house. The Father is here to remove our shame and make us new. Come to the Father's house. Because when we come to God and we come in repentance, honest repentance, He will not turn us away. He will always welcome us with open arms. And He'll say, "Welcome home, my son, my daughter. I've got something good for you." And so sometimes it's the salvation repentance where you've never trusted in Jesus for your own saving. Maybe you've been trusting in yourself for your saving. Maybe you've been trusting in things or money or whatever. And you've been looking to other things outside of God to find salvation. Well, repentance in that case is changing that mindset so that you're trusting in Jesus alone. So that's one form of repentance, and I would say that's the most important form of repentance. But then there's also other forms of repentance that, as we're walking with God, we repent of sin, which it's any thought, attitude, or action that goes against the will of God is what sin is. Any thought, attitude, or action that goes against what God says is right. And when we're following Jesus, as we look to Jesus, more and more, He gently points out things that we can turn from. And, you know, the awesome thing is that He doesn't ask us to turn from those things because He's mad at us. He doesn't ask us to turn because He's upset with us. It's because of the "and." It's because there are blessings that God wants to pour into your life in a greater and greater way when you say yes to Jesus and you turn from those things that aren't pleasing to Him. It says in the Word that we should repent so that times of refreshing from God might come. Times are refreshing. I don't know about you, church, but I could use a time of refreshing during COVID-19. Anyone else? And I feel like that as a nation, we have a real opportunity. As people, we have a real opportunity to turn back to God. For it said that repentance is you're walking down one path, and not only do you turn around, but you begin walking towards God. And honestly, that is the biggest part of the battle, because when you're focused on Jesus, he will help you overcome whatever sin, whatever hindrance, whatever thing is holding you back. The more you walk in the light of Christ, the less the darkness that is trying to hold on to you will remain. And so it's not just turning around trying to do it in our own strength. It's turning around and saying, Jesus, I see you. I'm coming towards you. And of course, his arms are open, waiting for us. Because with repentance, there's always a reward. So what's repentance? Repentance is simply a change of mind that results in a change of action. As one person said, repentance involves recognizing that you have thought wrongly in the past and determined to think rightly in the future. The repentant person has second thoughts about the mindset he formerly embraced. There is a change of disposition and a new way of thinking about God, about sin, about holiness, and about doing God's will. 2 Corinthians 7:10 puts it well. For the kind of sorrow God wants us to experience leads us away from sin and results in salvation. There's no regret for that kind of sorrow. But worldly sorrow, which lacks repentance, results in spiritual death. So you can think of it as regret versus taking it to heart before God and therefore making a change. Now, I can regret eating too much chocolate. Why? Because my stomach hurts after I eat too much chocolate, especially if it's sugar-free. Watch out, people. It's not good what happens after that. So I can regret that. But, for example, godly sorrow would mean that I'm changing my mind about ever eating that much chocolate again. You see the difference? Whatever your, quote, chocolate is, we have a choice. We can say, I regret that because there's some consequences in my life now. Or, I actually need to change my mind about doing this because God is convicting, is bringing awareness to my heart about this situation. And ultimately, that godly sorrow where your heart is broken about the situation leads you to repentance. And that's good. Because repentance always has a what? Reward. So, just a quick example of what repentance might look like, all we need to do is look at the story of Zacchaeus. Zacchaeus was a wee little man. Come on, I read about him in Sunday school. Here was a man who he cheated and stole and lived on ill-gotten gains. Maybe he was a politician, I don't know. But at one point, he met Jesus. And at that point, he had a radical change of mind. Look, Lord, said Zacchaeus, here and now I give half of my possessions to the poor. And if I have cheated anybody out of anything, I will pay back four times the amount. Now that's repentance, isn't it? It's not just, oh, I feel bad that maybe I cheated some people. No, it's, Lord, I'm looking to you, and now I'm going to pay back all of what I stole. And Jesus said to him, today salvation has come to this house, since he is also a son of Abraham. You know, tax collectors were hated by the people, especially the Jewish people. And so for Jesus to say, no, this is a son of mine, it was revolutionary. The cheat became a philanthropist. The thief made restitution. That's repentance coupled with faith in Jesus. So that's personal repentance, repentance from sin unto salvation. But there's also a place for corporate repentance. Last week, there was a gathering of about 50,000 Christians that were down in Washington, D.C. They were actually a couple different events that they were there for. But each one of those events led to worship, prayer, and repentance. Worship, prayer, and repentance. And it was a very, very powerful thing. You know, our nation has a lot of things we need to repent for. There is still many things that are encouraged, allowed, taught, that are just evil, that are just against God's will, against the scriptures, against what's right. And I do believe God is gracious, he is merciful, but he's also just. And at some point, we might have to face God's judgment for what we continue to allow in our land. And Satan's done a really good job of changing things that were once evil into things that are now acceptable. Not only acceptable, but they're taught. There's taxpayer money behind them. It's evil. It's evil. I'm not going to go off on the list of what all those things are. Open your Bible, okay? Before you claim something is okay, open your Bible and see what God says about it. Before you change, I don't want to go there. Before you make major life decisions, go to your Bible. See what the Lord says about it. Because he wants nothing but good for you. And there are some things, many things, that the Bible clearly shows us are sin, are wrong, are out of place, are not God's best, are not God's original design. God doesn't make mistakes. He didn't make a mistake when he created you. You are his chosen child. In the image of God, you were created male and female. God created you exactly how he wanted to create you. And we shouldn't mess with that. But of course, one of Satan's greatest ploys is to come in and twist. Actually, that's what the word pervert means, is to twist. He's come and he's twisted the truth. And now in our land, we have a whole bunch of confusion, a whole bunch of people making choices that are going to end up hurting them in the end. When God says, just come to me. Come to me. I'll be your peace. I'll be your hope. I'll be your joy. I'll love you like you weren't able to receive at home from your father or mother. And so we're calling evil good and good evil. And again, I believe that judgment might come for that. We know that at the end, judgment will come for all who do evil. And that's why we need to turn to the Son. And that's why Jesus invites each of us, everyone, to turn to him. Because the days are growing evil. You know, so church, I hope this isn't too heavy. We need hope in this time, right? But our hope is Jesus. Our hope during this pandemic is Jesus. And sometimes we need to wake up and realize that we have a problem. The problem is sin. And Jesus is the hope for our lives, personally and for our nation. And so in 2 Chronicles chapter 7, you can open a Bible and look with me if you want. 2 Chronicles chapter 7, Solomon was about to dedicate the temple to God. This was a special, special event because the Israelites desired that God would dwell among them. And this was the first building that God ever said, yes, I will bless this specific place on earth, and I will send my spirit, and I will send my presence and my glory to fill this building. And so the people of Israel were ecstatic. They couldn't believe that God would allow his presence to be in one place and in their capital at that. It says in 2 Chronicles chapter 7, verse 1, when Solomon finished praying, fire came down from heaven and consumed the burnt offering and sacrifices, and the glory of the Lord filled the temple. Church, did you know that that's what God desires for us? That through the Holy Spirit, we are the temple of God? And he wants the glory of the Lord to fill us? What an awesome thing. And that's why we come to him and we repent and we lay ourselves down. We say, Lord, take away anything within me that defiles. Verse 2 says, the priest could not enter the temple of the Lord because the glory of the Lord filled it. When all the Israelites saw the fire coming down and the glory of the Lord above the temple, they knelt on the pavement with their faces to the ground and they worshiped and gave thanks to the Lord, saying, he is good, his love endures forever. Again, this is the first time that God had poured out his presence on one physical place. And so they celebrated and they sacrificed countless animals to God in that time, and they worshiped. Verse 11, it says, when Solomon had finished the temple of the Lord in the royal palace and had succeeded in carrying out all he had in mind to do in the temple of the Lord and in his own palace, the Lord appeared to him at night and said, I have heard your prayer and have chosen this place for myself as a temple for sacrifices. Now listen to this. This is really key, I think, because God is warning them and yet exhorting them at the same time. When I shut up the heavens so that there is no rain, or command locusts to devour the land, or, get this, send a plague among my people, if my people, who are called by my name, will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will turn from heaven. I will forgive their sin and heal their land. Church, that's what we need. That is the cure for the heart of America. I'm not claiming necessarily that God has sent judgment through this pandemic, but I do know there's a chance of that. And I also do know that God will sometimes allow evil so that people turn back to him. And that is what's happening, right? God has allowed this evil in the land. I can't say that God is the initiator of the evil, but he's allowed it, and it's affecting the entire earth. Why? Because he wants people to be drawn back to him. And I feel like that we have kind of missed the message a little bit. Because part of this process of turning back to him is repentance. Part of this is saying, God, we're wrong. You're right. Forgive us. Forgive our nation. Forgive our land. We have sinned against you. And as followers of Jesus, guess what? Even though we might not have participated in these sins, you know, we've all sinned, but maybe we haven't participated in these, quote, big sins, we can stand in place of those who have and repent on behalf of our nation. We can be the ones to lead the way to turning back to God, saying, God, forgive us. Lord, forgive us. When Nehemiah, he was able to go back, he was sent back to rebuild the walls of his land. The first thing he did is he said, Lord, forgive us. Even though Nehemiah was a righteous man, he hadn't done any of the sins that the people of Israel were doing. He said, God, forgive us. We've turned away from you. We've turned to idols. And then he was able to be sent back and the walls could be rebuilt. So, church, that's my encouragement. There is always a reward with repentance. And we are his people. If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves, it takes humility, right? It takes a realization that we don't have it all together. Will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and I will forgive their sin and heal their land. Church, I want our land to be healed. I mean, our nation has never been so messed up, if you will. It's never been so divided. It's never been so hate-filled. We need Jesus. We need to turn towards him. And he's good. He will hear us. One of the major reasons that God said that he would pull away and send a plague or send judgment was if Israel turned from him and turned to false gods of the nations around them, turned to idols, turn to anything that they put before God in their lives. Well, what are some modern idols? What are some things that we pour ourselves into that may be good in small measures, but consume us? What are some things that we just worship before we worship God? Career success, personal success. Here's a biggie. Our children's success, right? That's like, we will do anything to see our kids thrive and survive. And to an extent, that's a great thing, right? Because God cares about kids and parents should care about kids. But I think it crosses a line sometimes when, as an example, I'll use church as an example, when there's absolutely no time to do anything with or for church because we're so consumed doing everything else for our children. I think we cross some lines sometimes. You can stone me afterwards. It's okay. But I think we need to, a little bit, the pandemic can be teaching us a lesson of, let's put first things first. Let's not always do everything for our own personal success, our stuff, our recreation. Some good things have happened about this pandemic. I think families have been together more than ever before in recent history, right? Because we've had no choice. Now, you might say that's driving you crazy, and you might not like that too much, but it's an opportunity as well to say, wow, we're together, we're having meals together, we're praying together. Use this as an opportunity to bless your family and to just be together. So I think that COVID has potentially had some cleansing effect. You know, we're looking for the positives in this. I do miss how things were. I miss the activities our kids were in. I miss not wearing a mask in public, some of these silly things. But you know what? We can look at the positive and we can say, God, you're doing something here through this. Let's focus in on that. So let's draw closer to the Lord. Psalm 51, again, you can turn there with me if you want. I want to run through Psalm 51 because I think it's just a beautiful picture of what repentance looks like. Now, this was just after David had been confronted by the prophet of God for committing adultery, covering it up through murder in order to exonerate himself and appear like he's innocent. And, of course, Nathan the prophet shows up and challenges him and says, you know, gives an example of sheep and David being a shepherd. He totally related with that. And he said, wow, I am in the wrong. So in Psalm 51, it says, have mercy on me, O God, according to your steadfast love, according to your abundant mercy, blot out my transgressions. So David starts off by appealing to the mercy of God. And I want to encourage you, again, with repentance comes a reward. Appeal to God's mercy. Say, Lord, I'm bringing this to you. I know I don't deserve forgiveness. I know I don't deserve grace in this time, but I'm bringing it to you and I'm asking you for it. And you know what? God is merciful. Verse 2 says, wash me thoroughly from my iniquity. Cleanse me from my sin. For I know my transgressions and my sin is ever before me. Admitting your sin is probably the hardest thing to do, right? It takes humility. It takes courage. It takes some introspection to slow down enough and say, yep, I've got some issues that I need to bring to my Savior. But once we can get there, freedom comes with those steps. And so the next step, or step one, excuse me, is to admit your sin. Just admit it. You don't need to come to me to admit it. You don't need to go to a priest to admit it. You can admit it right to God, right? And of course, it always helps to be in community because James teaches us to confess our sins one to another so that we might be healed. And that's why I really encourage small groups. You know, you don't have to, you know, air out your deepest, darkest things, but you know what? I encourage that with you and another person in God. But in small group, you can confess, you know, I'm struggling today. I'm going through a hard time. I'm feeling depressed. I'm feeling discouraged. You know, those might not be sins, but they're things that we're dealing with in our life. And that's why we need that connection. That's why we need that community, so that we can build each other up. Say, hey, brother, hey, sister, I'm there with you. I'm glad you're here with me today. Confess your sins and pray for each other so you might be healed. The earnest prayer of a righteous person has great power and produces wonderful results. Step two is to avoid defensiveness and see God rightly. Verse 4 of Psalm 51 says, against you and you only have I sinned and done what is evil in your sight so that you may be justified in your words and blameless in your judgment. So our sin, it does affect other people, right? When we sin outwardly, you know, we're hurting someone. But David sees it first and foremost in the right way. Against you and you alone, God, have I sinned. There's not one sin that's worse than the other as far as in God's sight. We're all held accountable to our sin. There are, of course, worse consequences for different types of sin. But regardless, we need to go to God first and say, God, I repent. Against you alone have I sinned. John Piper gives us perspective. He says, we must also be aware of one of the biggest hindrances to obtaining a broken heart, our neglect of the relational aspect of sinning. By this, I mean that we can view sin as a failure of performance rather than a failure of intimacy. I love that idea that, you know, sometimes we fail and we just beat ourselves up and we blame ourselves. And really, it was a failure of being close to God. And so when we continue to beat ourselves up, guess what? We feel like we're further and further from God. And yet God is calling us back. My son, my daughter, just stay close with me. Because when we're close with him, guess what? We sin less. We're not sinless, but we sin less because we're close with him. Piper continues, finally, true repentance comes not merely by understanding the relational aspect of sin, but by understanding the nature of the one with whom we are in relationship. In other words, the more we see God as glorious and holy, the more we will see sin as something to weep over. Repentance is less about feeling bad over behavior and more about feeling awe and delight towards God. I love that. Psalm 51:5. Behold, I was brought forth in iniquity, and in sin did my mother conceive me. The idea of original sin. Gosh, I don't have to teach my 2-year-old how to sin. They come out knowing, right? One of the cutest memories. I'll pick on Sam a little bit. I think he was 3 when we brought Ashton home, and the first things out of Sam's mouth was, I won't hit him. Which, of course, meant the first thing he thought about was hitting his brother. Don't have to teach sin. It's born in us. That's why we all need Jesus, no matter where we're at in life. Verse 6, behold, you delight in truth in the inward being. You teach me wisdom in the secret heart. Purge me with hyssop, and I shall be clean. Wash me, and I shall be whiter than snow. And that's our encouragement that we need to look to Jesus. Hyssop is what they dipped blood in when they sprinkled it in the temple. And so, for us to be made whiter than snow, we need to look no further than the cross of Christ. And he is there to welcome us. Continuing on, let me hear joy and gladness. Let the bones you have broken rejoice. Hide your face from my sins and blot out all my iniquities. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. I love Psalm 51:10. Ultimately, repentance is the work of God. By his kindness and grace, we are led to repent. Right? Like if God didn't point things out in us, we wouldn't change, would we? I mean, maybe after enough consequences, we'd be like, oh, that's not smart. I'm going to stop doing that. But how much better when his Holy Spirit just gently points something out to us and says, hey, go the other direction. There's so much grace and kindness when God does that for us. Verse 11, cast me not away from your presence. Take not your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation and uphold me with a willing spirit. Step 4 is be filled and receive encouragement from the Holy Spirit daily. Ephesians chapter 5 says, don't be drunk with wine because that will ruin your life. Instead, be filled with the Holy Spirit. You know, I believe that when we trust in Christ, we receive a portion of the Holy Spirit. It's kind of like a pilot light. But you know what? That pilot light wants to come into full flame in our lives. And when we ask to be filled with the Holy Spirit, he will come. He will ignite that thing. And it'll explode. It'll explode in good works. It'll explode in understanding God's word better. It might explode through a spiritual gift. Maybe you'll speak in tongues. Maybe you'll receive a word of wisdom or revelation. Ask the Holy Spirit to fill you. You know, the Holy Spirit's a gentleman. He's not going to give you something weird unless he thinks you can handle it, okay? You won't start speaking in tongues unless you are in agreement that you want to speak in tongues, all right? But you can seek those things because they're a gift from God. The New Testament is full of pictures of what it looks like to be filled with the Holy Spirit. Verse 13, David says, then I will teach transgressors your ways, and sinners will return to you. Deliver me from blood guiltiness, O God. O God of my salvation, and my tongue will sing aloud of your righteousness. O Lord, open my lips, and my mouth will declare your praise. It's such a wonderful thing to know you're forgiven. Like, I know at times when I've struggled and just felt God's presence after I've turned to him, and to know that joy that wells up within. Yeah, you just worship. Say, God, you're worthy. And that joy just comes out of your life. Verse 16 says, "For you will not delight in sacrifice, or I would give it. You would not be pleased with a burnt offering. The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart, O God, you will not despise." I think that's a real attitude of worship, having that broken and contrite heart. Even it's an attitude of repentance. You know, we don't have to repent just when we blew it really bad. We can walk with an attitude that's humble before God. You just say, "Lord, I'm drawing near to you each and every day." Staying close to him. Verse 18, "Do good design in your good pleasure. Build up the walls of Jerusalem. Then you will delight in right sacrifices and burnt offerings and whole burnt offerings. Then bulls will be offered on your altar." So David's saying, good things are going to happen when we return to the Lord, when we repent. Church, repentance always comes with a reward. I don't know what you're going through today. I don't know what God is speaking in your heart or in your life. Maybe during the next week you might feel a call from the Lord to pray more specifically about the sins of this nation, to repent on behalf of this land. Maybe God is speaking to you personally and he's pointing something out in your heart. And he's saying, come to me. My reward is here for you. Just give it to me. And when we do, you know what? He takes it. He forgives it. It says that he spreads our sin away from us as the east is from the west. And he remembers it no more. Why? Because he can't remember it? No, because he chooses not to remember it. The church, let's not live for something less. But why? You know? Why live in a place of bondage? Let's bring the areas of our life where we're missing the mark to the Lord, because he longs for us to be close to him, and his reward is here for us. Would you pray with me? Heavenly Father, we come before you today. Jesus, we are so very grateful for your forgiveness. Lord, I thank you that you love us. God, I thank you that you're kind. I thank you that you're merciful. Lord, I pray that you would point out those areas of our life where we're walking in bondage or in sin. God, I thank you that you don't come to us with a heart to condemn us, but a heart to set us free. So Lord, I pray that you would just, by your Holy Spirit, reveal gracefully, graciously those areas of our life where we need to turn to you and look to you for hope. Father, help us to admit our sin, Lord, and turn from them, God. Lord, I thank you that that's an individual walk, Lord, that you're calling each one of us to yourself, God. Lord, we also have a corporate walk. We're together. We are God's people. And so, Lord, I pray that you'd help us, God, to turn our hearts to you. Lord, we recognize that without you, we have nothing, that this country needs you. So, Lord, we do humble ourselves, and we pray, God, that you would forgive our land. Father, that we would turn from our sinful ways, our sinful ideologies that are against your word. And, Father, help us turn back to you, I pray. I pray that you bless your people this morning. Bless your people in the name of Jesus, because you love us deeply. We love you, Lord. And we thank you, God, that we were able to gather today, Father, in spite of this pandemic, and I pray for safety for each one here in Jesus' name. Lord, I pray that you'd go before us this week. Father, just like you did for Israel with the pillar and the fire, God, I pray that you'd go before us and consume our enemies. Protect us, Lord, from the evil one. Protect us from the pandemic, God. And help us to shine brightly as carriers for you in these days. In the name of Jesus. All God's people said, amen. Amen. God bless you. May his peace go before you. Have a great week. Life groups will start around 11:30. So again, today we have Alpha. and the fear or anxiety group. Fear versus faith. Thank you. I was close. God bless you. Also, prayer team is available. Kelly and Jane, if you'd like prayer, come on up, receive prayer. If not, be blessed.